Then we'll go to the next kind of price leadership model, and the next kind of price leadership leadership model is where the price is set by the dominant firm. So in this case, the price leadership typically in this form of oligopoly, here one dominant firm sets price and all the smaller firm in the industry follow its pricing policy. So one firm is going to, typically the dominant firm, they are going to decide the price and other firms, they are going to follow it. Now, before going into the detail that what is the outcome or how the price output of the other firms get affected, we'll understand what is the meaning of a dominant firm, how the firm become emerge as a dominant leader, and what is their trait when they become the dominant firm in the market. So, if you look at the first feature of oligopoly, we say that even if there are large number of firms in the oligopoly, at least few of them have to lead the market or few of them have to dominate the market, right? At least two of them should have the having the largest market share in the typical market. So oligopoly market is dominated by few firms. Among the one may be the larger player, at least one or two have to the larger player. So, if you take the example, when you talk about a search engine, Google is the largest market share. When you talk about a chip, Intel is the largest market share. When you talk about a mobile phone, Nokia is the largest market share. When you talk about the PC segment, IBM is the largest market player. When you talk about, at least before the liberalization, when you talk about the car industry, Maruti was having the highest market share. When you talk about a steel furniture, Godrej is having the larger player. So in all this segment, if you look at, there are many firms, but when it comes to the larger player, they are the larger player in their own segment, and that's why they emerge as a dominant firm, because they are having a largest market share as compared to the other firm, those who are having a smaller market share. The other firms here, what is the basic or what is the success of this dominant firm depends. The other firms acknowledge the leadership of the largest firm for the price determination. So when it comes to dominant firm, even if they are the large, they have the largest market share, they are the large firm in the market, the other firms should accept them as the large firm, or the other firms should acknowledge when they are giving the, or when they are fixing up the price, the other firms should follow it. And in other way, we can say that the other firms have to accept this firm as the large market share, then only they will follow the price whatever decided by the dominant firm. So dominant firm is a leader in term of market share or presence in all segment, or just being the pioneer in the particular product agency. Product category. So, dominant firm may be the leader in terms of the market share, either they are having a maximum market share or their presence in all the segment, or just being a pioneer in the particular product category. In all these three, when they are having this, all these three characteristics, or one of these three characteristics, they can be the dominant firm. So, this dominant firm is very, or if they are getting into a leader, they have to be very large in size. An economies of scale, produce optimum output at which he is able to maximize the return. So, this price leaders or the dominant firm has to be very large in size, and they have to earn economies of scale, then only they can consider as the dominant firm, because they are having a large market share and they are getting the profit, and they should produce at the optimum output. They should not produce at a output level where which leaves some excess capacity for the firm. When it comes to a trait of the dominant firm, the dominant firm can be either benevolent or they can be the exploitative firm. Either they can be benevolent for the other firms in the market, or they can be the exploitative firm in the market. Now, who is a benevolent firm, or who are the benevolent firm? The benevolent firm allow other firm to exist by fixing up a price at which small firm may also sell. So, if the dominant or the market leader is the benevolent firm, their trait says that if they are fixing up a price, they fix at that level where even the small firm can also survive. So they generally fix up with the price which is above the marginal cost of the small firms, then only that will actually lead the small firm to survive in the market, or that price leads the firms to get some amount of the profit, specifically the small firms in the market to get some amount of the profit. Now, how the firms, they become a benevolent firm? Because all the dominant firm, they are not the benevolent firm. Some firms, they are there, some dominance firm are there, they generally the exploit other firms taking the cue from there, the dominant firm are taking the cue that they are the large firm in the market. Now, what situation leads to the creation of this benevolent firm? It lets other exist, so it doesn't have to face allegation of the monopoly creation. So, if someone is having a 90% share, rather than getting into the allegation that they are trying to monopolize, they become nice to the other small firms and they allow them to survive. In that way, they also avoid the allegation of the monopoly creation and they emerge as a benevolent trader because they allow the small firm to stay in the market. So, one way to get away from the allegation of the monopolization or the monopoly creation, they become the benevolent firm. Second, it earns sufficient margin at the price and still remain market leadership. So, whatever the price they are charging, they earn maximum or the sufficient margin at this price and still retain the market leadership. And success of this type of leadership depends on the assumption that the other will follow the leader. So, when it comes to this price leadership by a dominant firm, obviously if you look at from the angle of small firm also, they cannot compete directly with the large firm. So, in that case the only options available to them that they are following the leader, and if they are following the leader, maybe the out of goodwill, the if the dominant firm is a benevolent firm, they will at least think about the small firm and they will fix up a price which is lower than their standard, and by with that price at least the small firms getting some amount of the profit. Then the other category of dominant firm is the firm who exploits the small firms in the market. And how do they exploit the small firm in the market? They fixes a price at which small inefficient player may not survive, and thus it gains a large share of the market. So, in this case the firm set up a price to exploit the small firm, and what they do? They set a price in such a level where the small firm or the firm those who are not doing well in the last period, they are going to get out of this market, or they will get the exit out of this market. So, in this case the price whatever given by the firm that will not suit the small inefficient player in the market, they will be out of the market, and in this case the dominant firm become more dominant because they also get the share of the of small firm those who have already exit out of this market. So, we will see the graphical explanation and algebraic explanation of this dominant firm. Generally graphically how we get the demand curve of the dominant firm, how the supply curve gets extracted from the supply curve for the rest of the firm, and we will see how generally the small firms is, whether it is suitable for them, till how long the small firm will be there in the market, at what stage generally they go out of this market. So, we will get a demand curve, this is the market demand curve, then we will get a supply curve, and correspondingly we will get the price. Okay. And this is the demand curve of the large firm, this is the price. Okay. then we'll find out the this is the marginal revenue curve, then we'll get the marginal cost corresponding to marginal revenue and marginal cost, we'll get the price, that is by the dominant form, that is P2, this is P3, this is P1, this is E, this we can call as P2 dash, this is our DL, and here we can call it as B1, here we can call it as E, this is our Q, this is our O. Okay, so let's understand this graph now. This SS, if you look at, suppose we understand that there is one large firm and number of small firms. Okay, so this supply curve, if you look at this S, you can call it SS dash, this is the aggregate supply curve of the small firms. This is not the aggregate, this is here the supply of the dominant firm is not added. This is the aggregate supply curve of only the small firms that is there in the market. And how we get this SS dash? This is the horizontal summation of the marginal cost curve of all the small firms. This demand curve is the market demand curve where we have also added the demand for the dominant firm product. The difference between the horizontal difference between the demand curve and supply curve, if you look at, that will give us the demand between that will give us the demand by the dominant firm. So if you look at, in that, through that we get the demand function, that is DDL, that is the demand function for the large firm or the demand function of the dominant firm. So the horizontal distance between the supply curve and the supply curve of the small firms and the market demand curve, that gives us the demand curve of the dominant firm. So the if you look at, the logic is very simple. Total demand is this much, this is the total supply of the small firm. So whatever the gap between the market demand and the supply of the small firms, from there generally the emerges the demand curve for the large firm, because the rest of the demand has to be given from the dominant firm. Now price falls below, at any point of time if the price falls below P1, which is the market price decided on the basis of the supply curve of small one and the market demand, if price falls below P1, generally the demand curve for the large firm increases, because this is the market demand, this is the demand curve for the large firm. If price falls below this, the demand curve for this dominant firm increases, because once price decreases, demand is more than the supply, and that leaves the scope for the more demand for the dominant firm. Now how we get the price P2? We get the price P2 following the marginal cost and marginal revenue rule. So doing this, we get this price P2, and at this price P2, the total demand is P2B, and small firms supply only the amount. Here if you look at, this is the P2A. So here we can call it, this is the B. So at this price, if the price fixed by marginal cost, marginal revenue rule, that is by the dominant firm, because price has to set by dominant firm, this is the marginal revenue curve of the dominant firm, this is the marginal cost function of the dominant firm. Taking this, the price is decided by the dominant firm. If the price is decided by the dominant firm, at this price, small firm just supply this much, because this is the supply curve for the small firm, and the large firm, they supply, what is the large firm they supply? Large firm they supply AB. So in this case, if you look at, this has to be given for the demand for the dominant firm, and in this case, this is what they are going to, this is the demand for the dominant firm, and this is what they are going to supply. If the price is P3, up to this, if you look at the supply given by the small farm is 0. And at this point, now this is entirely the demand for the large farm, because the supply is not going to get by the small farm. So, the entire demand is get satisfied from the small farm, from the large farm, because small farm is not supplying anything when price is P3. Any price below this P3, supply curve for the small farm is not existing, because this is the price beyond which the small farm is not going to supply in the market, or small farm is not going to sell in the market. So, that is the reason, if you look at when the price is given by the dominant farm, when the price leadership is by the dominant farm, the amount what the supply, the getting supplied by the small farm is less, and the amount which is getting supplied by the large farm is more. So, that is how the dominant farm, if they are deciding the price, they are supplying more and the small farm is supplying less. So, now we will see numerically whether the share gets more by the large farm when they set the price, and less by the small farm because they are just following the price, or it gets a equal share, or it gets at least a proportionate share. So, to summarize this, how we can say this typically dominant farm? There is a market demand, and the demand comes to all the farms in the market, and we get the supply curve for the small farms on the where we do not consider the supply curve for the dominant farm. So, the gap between the supply given by the small farms and the total market demand for the product, that generally the demand curve for the dominant farm. So, we identify the demand curve, from there we find out the marginal revenue curve. We get the marginal cost curve. This is the marginal cost curve. On that basis, we set the price. When the price set by the dominant farm, this is the amount of supply that comes from the dominant farm, and this is the amount of supply that comes from the small farm. And correspondingly, if at any point of time, if the dominant farm would like to, if the dominant farm is going to exploit this number of small farms, they will reduce the price. And if they are reducing the price from P2 to P3, small farm is not supplying any more product in the market, or they are not taking care of the demand, market demand, and that what they will do, they will go out of this market, and the large market or the dominant market, they get all the share of the total market and they become the monopoly leader. So, in this case, if you look at the if it is a benevolent farm, they will not go beyond P2, they will give at least small portion of the market to be shared by the small farms. But if the dominant farm is not benevolent, rather they are in the exploit in nature, so they will prefer to charge the price P3, which is much below P2, because at this price the small farm will become inefficient, they will not able to survive, they will go out of the market, and the entire market share will go to the large farm. So, here the trait of this dominant leader comes, whether they are in a way to exploit the small farms, or they are the benevolent leader, because there it will make the difference that in this case this price leadership will lead to the monopoly situation, or it will not lead to a monopoly situation. Then we will just take a numerical or algebraic solution to this dominant farm leader in order to understand that how the share gets divided between the dominant farm and the small farms. So, we will assume that there are 6 farms in the market. So, one is dominant farm and rest 5 each small farms. Okay. So, this is the total market demand, that is 100 minus 2P, and QS is the supply of the small farms, supply function of the small farms excluding the large farm. So, QS is equal to 10 plus P. This is the combined supply function. to find the equilibrium output or equilibrium without the dominant firm, demand, that is QM, has to be equal to has to be equal to the supply. And if you take QM is equal to 100 minus 2P and QS is equal to 10 plus P, we get 3P is equal to 90, P is equal to 30. So, equilibrium price without the supply of the dominant firm, we get P is equal to 30. And what will be the supply here? If you put the value of the P here, then it's 10 plus P. So, that comes to 10 plus 30, which is equal to 40. How do you interpret this 40 now? This 40 is the total supply comes from the this 5 small firms. So, once we know the market demand, once we know the total supply, we can find out what is the demand for the dominant firm. So, total supply is 40 units. Now, we will find out what is the market demand, and the difference will give us what is the demand for the dominant firm. So, total supply is by the small firm is equal to 40 units and price is equal to 30 units. Now, this is the demand function for the dominant firm. So, this is QM minus QS. QM is the total market demand, QS is the supply of the small firm. So, QM minus QS, so this is 100 minus 2P minus 40. So, 60 minus 2P, that is the demand function for the dominant firm. So, total cost for dominant firm is given, that is 50 plus 60 QD plus 0.25 QD square. This is the total cost function. From here, we can find out the marginal cost function for the dominant firm. So, that will come as 60 plus 0.5 QD. From the demand function, we will try to find out the total revenue function. From total revenue function, we will find out the marginal revenue function. Just now, we calculated the marginal cost function. So, we will follow the profit maximizing rule, the marginal cost, marginal revenue rule, in order to find out the price. So, to find this, we will find now total revenue for demand function. For this, we need the price, demand function for the dominated firm, and also the price for the dominated firm. So, how to find out this price of D? This is 30 minus 0.5 QD, and how we got this? Because our QD is equal to 60 minus 2P. Then we'll find this total revenue is equal to now 30 minus 0.5 QD multiplied by QD. So, that comes to 30 QD minus 0.5 QD square. This is the total revenue for dominated firm. Then we will find out the marginal revenue of dominated firm, that is derivative of total revenue with respect to DQD, and that comes to 30 minus QD. This is the marginal revenue for D. So, we have a marginal cost function what we got previously. Now, we have the marginal revenue function. To find the price and quantity, now we will take the marginal cost and marginal revenue rule. So, at profit maximizing equilibrium, marginal cost of D has to be equal to the marginal revenue of D. So 6 plus 0.5 QD has to be equal to marginal revenue for D, that is 30 minus QD. Then simplifying this, we can get 1.5 QD is equal to 24, QD is equal to 16. So this is the demand, that is quantity that has to be produced by dominant farm. This is the price. Price is again 30 minus 0.5 QD. So this will give 30 minus 0.5 16. So this comes to 22. So price is 22, quantity demanded is 16. Now this price 22 has to be accepted by the small farm, because this is the price leadership model where there is the dominant farm has to set the price and small farm simply they have to follow this. So taking this price, now what will be the market demand? That is QM. So QM is equal to 100 minus 2P. So that comes to 100 minus 44, that is come to 56. This is our total market demand. What is the market demand for the dominant farm? The market demand for the dominant farm is the 16, and this is the total market demand. So rest, this 56 minus 16, 40 unit has to be supplied by the smaller farm. So if you try to analyze the result from here, price is 22, that is followed by small farms, and if the total market demand, if you look at, it's 56. Out of this, if not even less than one third is supplied by the dominant farm, and rest is supplied by the smaller farm. So maybe we can say that this is a kind of a price leadership, or the dominant leader is such that at least it is benevolent in nature, because that farm is setting a price such that at least more than two-thirds is getting supplied by the five smaller farm, and the dominant farm itself is supplying only less than one-third of the total market demand. So at least from the result, if you want to analyze and if you want to read between the line, at least you can say that the price is set by the dominant farm, which is benevolent in nature, because he is just supplying less than one-third of the total market demand, and the rest all is supplied by the smaller farms. So in case of low-cost farm, generally the low-cost farm set the price, other farm follow it. In case of dominant farm set the price, others they will follow it. And the third category of the price leadership is, if you look at it, the kind of more subjective in nature, when we'll find that there is no clear case of a low cost farm or no clear case of a dominant farm. In that case, what model to be followed? And in this case, the model follow is price leadership by the barometric farm. And here, why the need comes from the barometric farm? Because there is no clear cut emergence of a dominant farm or clear cut emergence of a low cost farm. So there is evidence in the some market that there is no single player is so large to emerge as leader, but there may be one firm which has better understanding of the market. So the firm may not be large in nature, they are not operating in the large scale of operations, but when it comes to making a leader, whether to make that firm as the leader, they are considered to be the leader because at least they have a better understanding of the market. So this firm acts like a barometer for the firms. And why they are known as the barometer firm, or the how, why they are considered as the barometer of the market? Because they have the better industry intelligence and can preempt and reinterpret the external environment in an effective manner. So suppose there is a change in the government policy, suppose there is a crisis, suppose there is an event which has some influence on the price and quantity combination or the demand of the market. So in this case, generally the barometric firm, they get into a situation where they are the best firm to judge the event and lead the price output decision on that manner. So they are considered as the barometric firm, and the barometric firm should act as the leader. They should decide the price, and the other firms, they have to simply follow this. So either the so three kind of models or three kind of arrangement in case of a price leadership model. Either the price has to set by the low cost firm, or the price has to set up by the dominant firm, or the price has to set up by the barometric firm. So in last couple of session we discuss about a oligopoly market structure, identifying two different kind of model. One is collusive models, another is the non-collusive model. Non-collusive model, where the oligopolist firm, they compete with each other, and in case of collusive model, they generally collude together to maximize the profit and also reduce uncertainty, and in the way if it look at that at least get some amount of the profit from the collusion. Next session we'll see that how game theory generally helps, or game theory as a tool helps the firms to analysis to analyze the firm's behavior or the group behavior in the oligopoly market, or typically how the economics of cooperation, what comes from the group behavior of the oligopoly firm, generally whether it's competition or whether it's collusion, both are considered as the group behavior. And next class we'll say game theory as a mathematical tool, how it helps to identify both the economics of cooperation, whether it's competition or whether it is collusion.